Hey, it's Frank J. Lopes here from the expo floor at NADA, and I've got an absolutely fantastic show for you. My good friend, my so close friend who I love so much, who's sitting right next to me, which you can't see her yet, Yvette Roybal is on the show. Don't go anywhere. Live with Lopes is live from NADA.
What up, guys? It's Gary V, and it's time to get more Frank.
With DealerBuilt, forget about those intact printers and deliver a fully digital signing experience. Stupid simple.
Live with Lopes, the NADA shows brought to you by DealerBuilt, the real DMS that helps you run your dealership your way. And now, Frank J. Lopes.
Hey, welcome to episode... What episode?
Magic number 3.
Number 3. I am so bad with the numbers, right? I'm so bad with the numbers. Welcome to episode 3 of Live with Lopes from NADA. Hey, it is so fantastic to be here, and it's so fantastic to be here with my good friend, like really good friend. This was a big deal to get Yvette on the show. Yvette Roybal from Octane Buick GMC in Santa Fe. I'd give you a hug, but then like the wires would all pull and everything. So we'll just like hand hug. How's
that? Exactly.
It's so good to be here. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for having me.
So I was, okay. So I'm going to say this probably like 20 times over the thing, right? Over the whole weekend. But this is like the time I really mean it the most. No offense to anybody else, but I was really excited about you being on the show, right? And about number one, shocked you said yes in the first place. Okay. And number two, so super excited about you being on because I've always said there are so many people that need to hear your story because of the amount of motivation, the amount of inspiration that you could, that you have inside of you that you could just give out so freely and so easily. Okay. So let's start this the right professional way instead of me getting all mushy and over here and everything, right? Let's okay. Start this the right way, okay? And introduce yourself to everyone, please.
So my name is Yvette Roybal, and I'm the dealer principal of Octane Buick GMC. I'm part of the minority dealer program from General Motors, and I've been in the car business for 20-some years.
Okay, so this is a great place to start, to be honest, right? So what in the world got you into the car business in the first place?
Accident.
Like so many of us, right? By accident, right? Tell us a little bit more about it. What was the accident? It had to be some type of a thing had to actually happen, right? Some type of an event.
Actually, I just wanted to do something for a few months until I decided what I was going to do next, and I got sucked in, so it happens.
20-some-odd years later, that few months is... It's taken a little while, Yvette. I just got to tell you. You should have been past this little looking for something to do type of thing, right?
Yeah, for sure. I think everybody goes through that, right? You want to do something, and then before you know it, it's month end, and then you want to do something, and before you know it, it's month end, and so you live from one of those to the next, and then you, somewhere along the way, you fall in love.
And then the next thing you know, you're years into this type of thing already, right? And you're like, I kind of know what I'm doing, so I guess I may as well stay, you know? Do you think you know what you're doing yet?
Well, you think that you know what you're doing until the industry changes and evolves, and then you have to change and evolve. And so I think that it's just a constant change in perpetuity. And hopefully along the way you find gratitude and enjoy the ride and a lot of the things that bring you blessings and sleepless nights, et cetera. I mean, that's just the way it is, right?
It's definitely the way it is. Do you feel that you've had more sleepless nights over the last you know, over the last year than you have in the past or at any other time in your career?
No.
Okay. So tell me where this confidence comes from, this surety, because most people, they don't know what to do from one minute to the next.
Well, I think it's not a matter of knowing what to do. I think it's a matter of working on yourself and finding your own central piece and figuring out what that looks like, right? So somewhere in all of that, you got to decide that you're going to believe in your ability to fly, not the branch that you're standing on. So
what do you feel, where's your inner peace come from then?
So I have a son that's about to be 1 on the 19th, and I have a daughter that's about to be 4 on Sunday. So after you go through having all these young children around, you just realize that the childlike joy of life should be embraced more and more and more.
So with your son and your daughter, tell me that no car business stuff, right? Because now, because you know, the questions just come to me as you go along. Do you wind up loving one more than the other?
No.
You don't have one's not a little bit more of a favorite to you than the other one is?
No, I mean, I've spent more time with Sophia than I have with Sydney. So of course, you know, you have more memories or more lineage to build on, but you just love them.
I'll be the first one. I've got a favorite of your children. I've got not mine. Mine, of course, you know, I love them the same. But, you know, of yours, I've got a favorite because my little Sophia is just, she's amazing.
She's amazing.
So let's talk about Sophia a little bit.
Let's talk about her.
So we utilize her a lot. We utilize her talents and everything a lot in our, you know, in the commercials that we do. And just full disclosure, right? Because I work with Yvette very, very closely on her marketing and stuff like that. So this is why there's like, it's almost like you're watching the story of an inside type of story and stuff. But we utilize her a lot. And tell me, what kind of feedback have you gotten from that?
Well, everybody just loves it. I mean, her playthrough rates are incredible. And the most part of it is that she has fun with it. And when you're not around, and by the way, Sophia's the only other woman that could call Frank her Frank without Andrea getting mad.
This is very, very true. There's a very short list. It's Andrea and Sophia, and that's it. Like, nobody else is allowed to say that.
Every time she sees something, there's my Frank.
It's so, honestly, it's so awesome and such a blessing to be able to, number one, to know you and to know you at the level that we know each other. And then number two, to have her shared in my life too, which is very, very cool. Now,
just for the record, you try to talk me out of it.
That's exactly what I was about to say, is the fact that when you brought up the idea, like, I'm going to be the first one to admit, this was 100% your idea to use her in our marketing and everything. And I immediately said what to you?
You said you don't want to do that.
And you just were like, okay, let's try it. And you say I don't ever go along with your ideas, right? But and it's absolutely amazing because this was one, you remember what I said to you when you brought up the idea? I was like, I hope I'm wrong on this one. And I'm so happy that I was wrong because she is really like such a little star. Have you received any negativity whatsoever from anybody, like, oh, you've got your kid in the commercials and everything, that type of, anything like that?
You know, so we've been doing this, what, 2.5-3 years now, and I had one negative comment about that I needed to get another child actress. And you know, Sophia is not biologically my child. My wife carried her, and we had her via IVF, and so she doesn't look like me. Of course, she's my daughter. But so I had that one negative comment about it. But other than that, it's been nothing but good feedback, and she has lots and lots of fans.
She does have lots of fans. I think she's more famous than I am, to be honest, right?
She probably is.
Yeah, because that's not hard
her
to
Her URL
do.
Costs more than yours.
Yeah, it definitely does, that's for sure. Okay, so that's what, you know, so you could see that being a huge challenge and something that you would have to overcome and everything. But what other, that's really like an easy thing, honestly, to get over, because you knew right from the beginning that you were doing the right thing, and you just went with, you know, we followed your lead, you know, we went with your gut, and it obviously worked out. What other type of challenges have you been facing over the last, let's say, like over the last year? with the operation and with the day-to-day at the dealership?
I think more than anything, it wasn't so much a challenge, but a realization. One of the disservices that I feel that happened early on in the car business was, obviously I had a, you know, children way later on in life, and I started selling cars in my 20s, didn't have children until, you know, 39 years old. And everybody told me, don't be their mother. Like, that was the leadership advice, like, don't be their mother. And so I almost went all the way the opposite direction of that and tried to challenge and mentor people in a way that wasn't my superpower. Like, I finally realized after Sophia was born and here and I was interacting with her, that getting down on my knee on her level and looking her in the white of the eye and wanting absolutely positively of what was best for her, like, that was my superpower. So if anything that I would say is that, you know, women in leadership, they shouldn't be told don't be their mother, because that's their superpower.
So what, 20 some odd years, you must have come across a lot of, you know, a lot of different challenges, honestly, with being a woman in, you know, in, you know, in our business. And I don't want to do a whole, you know, because that, I think that one's just been like, it's been beat to death already and everything. But as you've come up, one of the things that I love and that's fascinating to me is, you know, is your story is very, very simple and very linear, right? Like, if you were to write out what is the path to becoming an owner, right, to becoming a dealer, what would that path look like? The way that you would write it out is the exact way that you played it, right? Became a salesperson, started selling cars, became a manager, right? Found an opportunity to be able to be a partner, did that, and then you just kept going. What roadblocks did you see that came up that were really hard? Now, the reason I'm asking you this is a really long question, right? The reason I'm asking you this like this is because I know that there's people that'll be watching, right? Mm-hmm. I know that there's women that are gonna be watching that are salespeople, and they're like, you know what, I'd really like to do that, but it seems like so foreign to them, you know? It seems so foreign, and there's gonna be challenges. Share some of those challenges and how you were able to get around them.
Well, I think the first challenge is yourself in deciding that, you know, that you're going to make that statement public. I remember the first time that I told somebody that we were at a golf tournament and they asked the question about, you know, where do you see yourself ending up in the car business? And I just said I was going to own a store one day. And, you know, you would have thought that I told them I was going to be Tiger Woods on the tee box.
just like that. Just you said, like, I'm going to own a store one day.
Yeah. But then after that, I shied away from it based on their reaction. I brought myself back, and it took a lot of courage to continue to press that forward. And so I think that we get in our own way so many times in our life by just not deciding innately that that's the desire of our heart and pursuing it with everything that we got.
How did the reaction make you feel? Like, describe how that, like, when you first heard somebody say that, like, what was that impact?
Well, I think that I just started realizing and rationalizing some validity behind the statement that that was going to be a very difficult feat. And so as that set in more, I started sunsetting my desires a little bit more and more every day. And so it does have an impact. And I think that that's one of the things, is that we use judgment a lot in just saying something to somebody, and we don't realize, you know, what the takeaway is going to be. And so, you know, probably be a little bit more cognitive of some of those statements.
So what happened to make you change your mind? What happened to make you go, you know what, that was just garbage talk that person said that day at that golf tournament, you know? Mm-hmm. What was there an instance, or did you have to, like, prop yourself up and be like, no, that person was wrong, they don't know what they're talking about? Or was there, like, an instant?
Well, I mean, I pushed myself forward in my career for many, many years, but the instance that took me to the place where I finally had the courage within myself to pursue getting a store was Sophia, and the fact that, you know, she was born with a heart condition, and you know this, and we were in UCLA and she had just had surgery, and I was on the phone with a coach and they said, you know, how do you convince your daughter to follow her dreams? And the world changed. There was a sea change in that moment, and I realized that the answer was that I follow mine and that she sees that. But then I realized once I hung up that phone that I started to have the courage to say, you know what, I need to do this.
So just at that, basically, like, it sounds like it was almost just like at that instant, like it was like a light bulb went off in a way. Am I hearing that correctly? Or,
well, I mean, a lot of things led up to that, you know, and a lot of doors got closed along the way. And so I was at a point where that decision was something that it was time, right? It was time. And it's one of those things, I think, that, you know, you get to a certain point in your career where you either do it now or you're not going to do it, right? I mean, mm-hmm. and that's just the reality of it. But I think everybody has that moment in their story, and I don't think it's something that's like significant in the sense of, you know, this happened that created this. It was all those moments leading up to that moment that finally, when that registered, I was like, wow, like, I need to do this.
I think there's a lot of people that moment comes and they shush it in their mind. They're like, no, that's silly talk. Why in the world would I think that? After you made the decision, did that type of stuff come, like, tell the truth, did that type of stuff like come back and you had to push it away and keep moving forward?
Yeah. And I think it still comes up, right? I mean, I think that we all struggle to some degree or level every single day with, you know, what is our potential? Like, are we chasing our potential?
Okay, so you wake up on a Tuesday, and the light bulb goes off, and you're like, okay, this is what I'm going to do. That's it, right? What's the next step? What's the next thing that you do? Because that light bulb goes off, I'm sure, for a bunch of people, but they don't know what to do. There really isn't very, very much of a, you know, of like a manual. You can't go to the library and grab a book and, you know, and take it out and say, okay, this is how you buy a car dealership. This is how you become an owner. This is how you do this. What was the first step that you took right after that?
I think that book exists. You wrote it, right?
Well, that wasn't specifically about buying a car dealership. That you could apply that to anything, you know? But okay, here you go. Okay, wise guy. Here we go. So if you want to, you know, so if you were to write the book, chapter one would be probably to decide, right? That's what you want to do. What's chapter two then?
Well, I think it's the matter of, you know, there's your skill set and then there's the vehicle, right? And so I think that we always look at the vehicle of how we're going to get there, and that seems so daunting. But along the way is like, are you applying every ounce of your skill set that you possibly can to get there? And, you know, you got to get lucky too, right? I mean, there's got to be some luck that's involved, and all the stars have to align, like a million things have to align in order to get to that moment in your life. Whatever it is, it doesn't matter whether it's a car dealership or whatever it is.
So if the star, what happens if the stars don't align? Do you just give up? Do you just stop? Do you just like, well, oh, I guess this wasn't for me. I guess it wasn't my time or whatever. What do?
You keep going. You keep going.
It's that simple. You just keep going.
Right.
So now let's fast forward a little bit, right?
Okay.
So now you're in Octane. You redo your office and it looks absolutely beautiful, and you got the frame on the TV, right? And the nice floor and everything. Her office is like really beautiful too, by the way, but you know. So you have all that, and then like the storms just come. You know, the storm comes and the wind gusts come and everything. How do you hold on? How do you hold on during that time when things are starting to like look bad for whatever reason, or the challenges are coming, or staffing challenges, or the factory doesn't see things eye to eye with you exactly the way that you would, or that you need them to do things and they don't do it? Where does that come from? Where's the power to go through? Where's that come from?
I think it's just first of all, it starts with gratitude, right? I mean, I think that you just need to innately be grateful for absolutely everything, and then you'll allow more things to come in. And then I think the other part of that is you just keep pressing forward, right? I mean, every day has enough worries of its own, and I think that that's where we're fundamentally get so lost in what we want to forecast and what we want to think that the future is going to look like. And I think the biggest thing that I've learned out of the whole entire pandemic is how to be where my feet are.
Okay, expand on that, because you've never even said that to me like at any other time. What in the world does it mean, be where your feet are?
It just means be present in the moment. Like, enjoy this time that I'm sitting here talking to you. Don't overthink it. Don't overprocess it. And just be here. Don't think about, you know, the next 5 minutes or 10 minutes or what that looks like. And I think that we struggle, right? We struggle as human beings to be present most of the time.
Do you think we do that a lot? Do you think we get into our own heads so much that it's almost crippling, and in reality we should just put all that stuff down and don't let that go on and just be like right here, right now, like you and I sitting here at this table in this dramatically cold expo hall, right?
Yeah, it's freezing.
It's freezing, and it is, so you guys have no idea how cold it is, right? So that's hard to do, though. Like, it's really, really hard to do. Like, what's the magic in that? What's the superpower you have?
It's harder not to do, right? I mean, it's harder not to do in every day that you go to bed that you realize that you didn't cherish that day. In the end of the day, I think that the most precious thing that we have is our time. And if we value that in the way that we value other things, then a lot of things would change.
Yeah, you're right. You're absolutely right. You know, because we only have so much time, no matter what. And none of us knows what that length of time really, really, really is.
It's true.
You know, it could be a year, it could be 20 years, 50 years, who in the world knows, you know? How much does that utilization of time, how much do the kids take from you in that now? Because that's something that a lot of people in your position that they struggle with, is they're putting so much into the dealership. They're putting so much time in. And even when they're not physically there, they're still mentally there. You know, how do you balance those two out? Because it's very, very complicated. And I honestly don't know many people who can do it well. So I'm saying that you do it well. So what's your secret on how do you balance that out the right way?
Well, I have somebody that helps me with that discipline. You know, I get the look from Hope, and that means put away the phone and be present. So I think after programmatically getting that over and over again, you realize, like, okay, this is what this is. But the kids don't take anything. They give you, right? Because they give you perspective. They give you energy. They give you purpose. They give you passion. They give you all of those things. So it's just a matter of when I'm with them, I want to be with them. And when I'm at the store, then I'm going to be at the store. And I think that's where we're backwards in the fact that, you know, we're not where our feet are. And if we're at where our feet are, we're going to accomplish more.
So here's a good one. I haven't asked you this, even just the two of us on the phone one day or at dinner or anything like that. So what's next for Yvette?
I need to finish my book.
Yeah. you do need to finish the book.
I do.
So give everybody a little bit of so we're going to do a little empowering exercise over here live. Okay? Right now, trust me, right now, she is like, why in the world did I say yes to this? Because I knew he was going to set me up on some kind of garbage like this, right? So, number one, tell everybody what the book is really going to be about.
Just a very candid depiction of my story. And it has lots and twists and turns, and it's very, very diverse. And I think it'll be interesting to some people.
What do you think the message is that most people are going to be able to extract out of, you know, out of your words and out of your writing?
I think it's just a matter of continue to pursue what you desire, continue to pursue what you want, and do it with all your heart.
And when is this book going to be out? You see, I'm looking for the commitment now, right? That you have to make in front of everybody here and in front of everybody who's watching live and everyone's going to watch this on a replay later on. When is this book going to come out?
You keep trying to nail me down to that date, you know?
I'm good at that. I'm good at, you know, like maneuvering it around. And next thing you know, bang, you just committed to something. And you're like, oh, wait a minute. Now I really have to do it. And that's the whole point of it. So let's put a date out there. Let's think. So what could we do? So could we do by the end of the year, right? Could we do at the end? Like, is this something that I would be able to order for somebody as like a Christmas present?
I don't think that would happen, because I think there's a lot of processes along the way that I don't, you know, necessarily know, but I think it could be finished in rough draft by the end of the year, ready to move on to the next phase of that. Yeah.
Okay. So it's safe to say a year from now.
Yes.
Okay.
I will say a year from now.
Okay. That's it. You heard it, right? You heard it. There are a whole bunch of witnesses here. 1 year from now, each and every one of us will be able to buy the book. We're not going to go for, oh, what's the title? I know I'm not going to do that to you, right? I've already done enough. You're already not liking this anymore. You're already done. So a year from now, we will be able to buy the book and actually read the story. So let's give some previews out, right? A couple of little previews. What do you think, people, it's going to be the most unexpected thing? Like, what are they going to read in that and go, oh my God, I never knew. I never thought she would go through it. She would suffer through this, if I have this challenge, whatever, right? What's going to be that shocking moment in the book?
I don't know. I think for everybody, it'll be different. I think everybody's going to draw some different thing out of that situation.
That's it.
Because, I mean, in the end of the day, it's what you emulate with more, right?
So you think it's all going to be in the eye of the beholder, so to say,
it's
right?
It's always in the eye of the beholder.
Well, I don't know. I want to read the book even more now, even though I know probably, what, 3/4 of the story that'll be in there. I still want to read the book, and I'm sure that each and every single one of you are. So now, look, you've made the commitment. Okay, a year from now, it's going to be out there and it's going to be available. There's a whole bunch of people watching. You got a lot of fans too. You see these comments down here? Like these comments are absolutely great. Mark
you
and
told
Vicky.
Me not to look at that.
I know. I told you not to look. Now I'm saying you can look, right? Because you can. I'm always telling everybody different things. Like I've never seen so many hearts and everything in the comments. And like what everybody, honestly, look what everybody sees in 20 minutes live. Over here, I get the blessing of seeing like at will, basically, you know, and at any time, because you really, really are a very, very special person and you have so much to share. And I know personally, there are so many people out there that can get exactly what it is that they need to be able to move to the next step, that they can get it from learning it from you. You know, that you can set the example, that you can show them that it is something that actually can be done. Like, it's not just a dream. It's not just a nice fairy tale story or something. Like, it can actually be done. So this is something that you've got to do. There are a lot of people that are depending on you. They need you to be able to do this, you know?
Pressure.
That's right, nothing but pressure from me. I'll give you even more pressure now. When everything is done, not when you die and move and go to heaven or anything like that, but when you're done with automotive, when you're done with everything, and you're going to be like, you know, I'm just going to be, you know, I'm just going to focus on me and relax and all that type of stuff. What do you want people to say about Yvette when they're like, hey, do you remember Yvette? What do you want them to say about you?
I want them to say whatever part of that impacted them.
That she made impact in my life.
Yeah.
I think that's absolutely fantastic, because if you don't make impact, what in the world's the point?
Exactly.
Right? What is the point? Hey, I told you it was going to be a good show, right? I told you it was going to be awesome. The one and only Yvette Roybal, where can people find you? Because now people who didn't know you before are going to be like, I need to know her. Where's the best place that they can follow
you? Well, they can connect with me on social media, obviously. Probably need to work on getting my website up too. I'm sure you're going to give me a whole to-do list after
this. Left that one totally off my list of things to, you know, my list of things to hit Yvette with live so that she has to answer, right? I totally left that one off. But
or they can connect with me. They can go to octanebuickgmc.com, and there's pictures of me and Sophie on there, soon to be Sydney as well, and we can connect there too.
You can always go buy a car. You can always go to Santa Fe and buy, yeah, you know, and buy a vehicle as well. Well, Yvette, thank you so much.
Thank you,
I love you. You're the absolute best.
I love you too.
And your message is one that absolutely, the book is a must, because your message is something that's going to, it's totally going to motivate people. It's going to show them that they can do it no matter what type of obstacles they're facing in their own mind or just in reality. They know that they can do it. So I'm looking forward to the book, and I'm sure everybody else is as well. But hey, we're not done. We're just getting ramped up. That's only how many episodes? 3.
Magic number 3.
Episode 4 coming up. Don't go anywhere. We will be right back with more Live with Lopes from NADA. Thank you.
Thank you.